going to shift gear and talk about potential downers. And so when we talk about downers, these are opposite in that they elicit activity in our parasympathetic nervous system. It slows our heart rate, slows our breathing. We already talked a bit about this in terms of opiates and narcotics. And these are agonists of each other. So if you combine different downers, you're going to get a stronger effect and a greater risk of overdose. Also, again, if you're combining downers and uppers, you are at greater risk of having heart attacks and other health outcomes. This would be like the idea if you combine a Red Bull, which is an upper, with alcohol, which is a downer. I do not recommend this. This is going to put you at a major health risk. Now, let's talk about some of these specific types of downers in more details. The first category we're going to talk about is what I'm calling sedatives. These could include barbiturates. They could also include benzodiazepines. What you may be familiar with these are the anti-anxiety pills. So these are things like Valium or clorazepam. These are pills that you take and they have a very temporary effect, but they have a very dramatic effect in slowing you down. Rather than an antidepressant, which you can take for months or years at a time, short-term anti-anxiety pills are usually associated with very strong withdrawal effects. They are so potent in slowing you down that when you come off of it the next day or the day after, your anxiety is heightened because of that withdrawal. So how do these work? Well, if you take something like a Valium, what basically it does is it releases your loss of GABA, inhibitory neurotransmitter, which will actually slow your brain down. It slows down your thought processes, it slows down activity in your panic and your fear circuits, and it allows you to calm down. We know there's lots of sleeping pills that work like this too, such as Ambien, although of course that can be very dangerous for other things, such as somebody's not fully asleep and not fully awake and they might do things they're not conscious of. But overall, these sedatives tend to be something that people take when they're on airplanes or when they're having a hard time sleeping because it'll slow them down. Some types of antihistamines might also be used for this. We know that Benadryl, for example, may have a sedative effect and it may actually make people fall asleep more easily. So sedatives can be very dangerous. There's actually a news briefing last year in the CBC talking about how overdoses and fatal overdoses of benzodiazepines are on the rise in Canada, specifically as people might be combining their anti-anxiety medicine and their sleeping pills. And because those are agonists for each other, they may be putting themselves at a greater risk for overdose. So just keep in mind, if you have prescriptions for any of this or you're using anything over the counter that is a sedative, to try and make sure you're not using too much of it at once. Another type of sedative, but one that tends to get its own category, is alcohol. So much like the sleeping pills and anti-anxiety pills we were just mentioning, alcohol does produce more GABA in the brain, which inhibits our activity, and it also blocks glutamate. So if you remember from U3, glutamate was one of our largest excitatory neurotransmitters. So if someone is ingesting alcohol through whatever their preferred alcohol method is, what they find is that their brain slows down in activity. This can inhibit their brain activity and really slow them down. So keep in mind, if you are combining sedatives and alcohol, those are agonists and you're going to have a stronger effect. So if you are taking something like sleeping pills as well as a nightcap, that can be very dangerous. And the final group of downers we'll talk about are the opiates or the narcotics. And so we already talked about this a bit in the tolerance section, but just as a reminder here, what happens here and what really makes the opiates or the narcotics stand out is how they release endorphins. And so endorphins, if you keep in mind, this is our pain suppressor neurotransmitter. This is when you whack your elbow. If you have lots of natural endorphins from a runner's high, you're not going to feel it as intensely. Sometimes opiates are prescribed for medicinal usage. Sometimes we see them prescribed after surgery for pain or during childbirth or anything of that nature. If somebody has chronic pain or if they have something like Crohn's disease or colitis, they might need something very strong to get them through their intertestinal pain. But we do know that a lot of opiates and narcotics are also used recreationally. And they're used recreationally because not just to suppress the pain, but also to suppress emotional pain and also to help prevent the really intense withdrawal symptoms. We know that even before someone becomes a habitual user, there can be really intense withdrawal even from one hit of a very potent narcotic. And then it becomes not so much about receiving the benefits of being high on a narcotic, but it's about preventing the adverse effects of withdrawal. So what can often happen when someone is really addicted to an opiate is not that they're chasing the highs or being stoned on it that matters, it's that they're trying to avoid the very overpowering withdrawal symptoms of the narcotic. So now that we talked about some uppers and downers in a very quick survey-like way, it's important to acknowledge the role the withdrawal plays in all of these. We know that in uppers, what tends to be very common is it elicits a strong reaction from the sympathetic nervous system. And so withdrawal effects tend to be things like headaches and grogginess, perhaps vomiting. And with the downers, because they bring someone really down, habitual use and subsequent withdrawal of using downers can be even worse than withdrawal from uppers. If you think about withdrawal from alcohol, it's very common to have the DTs, where there's a lot of shakes and a lot of vomiting. It's that the withdrawal from narcotics, by the third day after using the first hit of a narcotic or opiate, it's very common for people to be planning how to get their next hit because the withdrawal is so intense, with lots of jitteriness, shakiness, their heart starts palpitating, and it can be really scary. Now that we talked about uppers and downers, we're going to switch gears and talk about the last segment, and that is what I'm calling the all-arounders. And so regarding the all-arounders, what's really going on here is such a mixed bag. With all these exogenous psychoactive chemicals, it's important to understand they are eliciting lots of dopamine, lots of serotonin, lots of norepinephrine all over the place, with me calling out specific things unique to each kind of category. With these all-arounders, they are releasing so many different things that we're still very much studying it. And so two areas that we're definitely studying are the psychedelics and the cannabis-related drugs. And what we know is both of these types can elicit hallucinations. All types can elicit hallucinations, but we tend to find cannabis and psychedelics do the most often. So first, let's talk about cannabis usage. So you know that cannabis has been legal in Canada for, I believe, 2 years at this point. And so we're starting to have better literacy and better understanding of how the chemicals in cannabinoids work. And it's very complex, well beyond the scope of this course. But for the purposes of this class, we are going to differentiate between two chemicals found in cannabis plants, and that is CBD and THC. So with CBD, what is really going on there is that it's releasing dopamine, serotonin, endorphins. It can help people to feel more happy. It relieves pain. It's not a panacea. It's not a fix-all be-all. So where people say that cannabis can fix everything and they list 50 different medical conditions, it's very unlikely. But we do know that CBD can be used for people with chronic pain, as well as with nausea, as well as with some anxiety. So there does seem to be some effects there. Then we have THC. So THC is totally different, has a different structure, and it mimics the neurotransmitter anandamide. And so anandamide is the neurotransmitter that can cause hallucinations. It can cause these cognitive and sensory perceptions when a person feels stoned. It's when their cognitions might slow down, they might feel their focus is a little bit different, and when they have different tactile sensations, it might be very different. We also know that through the mimicking of anandamide, it might produce what's often called the munchies, in which a person has an increase in their appetite. So that's some of the very basics of what we know is going on in cannabis, but of course we know the picture is much more complicated than that. It's just a starting point. And the final section we're going to talk about is the psychedelics. And so with the psychedelics, there's lots of different versions. If we look at the pure chemical compositions, we can think about DMT or LSD. And some of the sources we can think about include magic mushrooms or the psilocybin. We can also think about ayahuasca, which is a bit of a brew. And we can also think about peyote, which comes from a non-prickly cactus, even though I have a prickly cactus in here. And what's been really fascinating about psychedelics is since the 1960s, their medicinal use has been put on the back burner globally. Although almost every type of recreational drug, whether it be heroin or tobacco or alcohol, can also be associated with some sort of medicinal usage, we have not investigated the medicinal usage of psychedelics thoroughly enough until the last 20 years. We started to find that psychedelics may benefit people who have chronic pain, who have depression, who have addictions to other substances, and who face terminal illness. What goes on when someone uses a psychedelic is still a relatively lesser known phenomena. But what we do know is it releases and mimics a serotonin-like chemical. And where the serotonin-like chemical acts is in the cingulate cortex, colored orange in my cross-section of the brain. This is just above the limbic system. And what it does is it makes this area go less active. It inhibits activity in the cingulate cortex. And what we're finding is that the cingulate cortex is the area of the brain that gives our sense of identity, that gives our ego. And when you mute that, you tend to forget who you are, and you just see not how you're connected to the universe, but just how everything's connected to everything. And so what often is a described experience by someone using LSD or mushrooms is that they forget who they are as a person and they just see the cosmos. They might have an existential or transcendent experience. It also can release a sensation of synesthesia where the different sensations and perceptions all overlap. One of the biggest things that goes on here, though, is endogamy in the brain. You may have heard me say a few times already that our brain learns different pathways. And it's like creating a path across a grassy field, and you just continue to use that path until the grass dies. Well, when someone is inhibited on a psychedelic, it's like all those paths in the grass get wiped clean, and you have to create new pathways. And all of a sudden, what you think you know gets erased, and you have to start completely over again. And so because of this, many people use psychedelics as a form of enlightenment and a form of spiritualism, and it has been tied to spiritualism in lots of cultural senses. But we are just now starting to look at the decriminalization and medicalization of psychedelics in North America. All right, so this has been Unit 5, Consciousness. We've covered a lot of things, from what we can hold in our mind, to how we sleep and dream, to what psychedelic drugs can do to us. I hope you've enjoyed it. You've now made it to the end.